गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, करंटली आवर वी आर स्टडिंग आवर सिक्स्थ यूनिट, दैट इज अनसर्टेनिटी। एंड टिल नाउ वी हैव सीन इट्स फर्स्ट पार्ट वेयर वी हैव स्टडीड द प्रोबेबिलिटी थ्योरी एंड वी हैव सीन इंडिपेंडेंट इवेंट कंडीशनल प्रोबेबिलिटी, हाउ टू कैलकुलेट कंडीशनल प्रोबेबिलिटी। एंड देन वी डिस्कस अबाउट बेज रूल, and today we are going to talk about Bayesian network. Okay, so let us see inference in Bayesian network. Sometimes it is also known as belief network. Now this Bayesian network is actually a graph, and more specifically it is a DAG graph, that is directed acyclic graph. So Bayesian network is actually a DAG graph, directed acyclic graph. So let me explain this through this example. This is very popular example of burglary and earthquake. Consider you have installed a burglary alarm system at your home, and it is fairly reliable system, and it responds to the burglary very fairly. It is not 100% accurate, but it fairly responds to the burglary. But on occasion it also responds to the earthquake, and this is a real example, and it happened with one lady from Los Angeles. That's why we are considering these two factors by which we alarm may be activated. And along with this, you have two neighbors, John and Mary. They have promised you to call if they hear alarm. So this is the scenario given. Now in Bayesian network we represent this model using this graph. And this is a DAG graph, which means directed acyclic graph. As you can see, there is no cycle here. That's why it is acyclic. Directed means it represents the relationship. So see, burglary is going to activate alarm, right? So this is a relationship between burglary and alarm. So this is known as casual relationship, because burglary is the cause of alarm. So we have a relationship here denoted by this graph direction. So it is a directed acyclic graph. And in Bayesian network, along with that, we represent the probability distribution. Now see, the nodes are represented by ovals, and those are the events actually. So burglary and earthquake, we don't have parent for these nodes. So this will be a priori probability of these events. A priori means which is calculated beforehand. And others are the conditional probability. So we are representing full joint distribution for other nodes. So remember, for the nodes which don't have parent, we'll calculate and represent a priori probability, and for other nodes we'll denote the full joint probability. So this Bayesian network is actually a data structure which is used to represent the dependency among the variables or events, and here we also represent any full joint probability distribution, and in many cases can do so very concisely. So all the information will be represented on the diagram itself. And we can utilize this information for calculating a probability of any event. Now we'll try to understand this figure. Now the probability of burglary is 0.001. And the earthquake probability is 0.02, and this is the full joint distribution of these two events. B stands for burglary and E stands for earthquake. The probability of alarm when both events are happening, that is T and T, is 0.95. okay, for burglary it is 0.94. okay, and then if you have earthquake alone, the probability is 0.29, and in some, due to some spooky reason, we may get alarm. Okay, so both events are false. Okay, it may be due to short circuit. Okay, and in that case also you may hear alarm. Okay, and then for John calling you in case of alarm, the probability is 0.9. okay, and both the person may get confused with the telephone ring. In that case also they will call you. Okay, so alarm is false, but with probability 0.05, John is calling you. Okay, so they may get confused with the telephone ring and they will call you and they will say there is a burglar at your home. Okay, and the let me erase this. The accuracy of John calling you is 0.9, whereas the probability of Mary is 0.7. Okay, so in the textbook it is given that Mary has a habit of listening to the loud music, that's why it's her accuracy is less as compared to John. Okay, so this is the given example. Now let us calculate probability for one of the event. Okay, so then it will be clearer to you how we are going to utilize Bayesian network for calculating the probability of some event. So here we are trying to calculate the probability that the alarm has sounded but neither burglary nor earthquake has occurred and both John and Mary called. Okay, so this is the given scenario. So let us put these variables. Okay, so probability is John called you, Mary called you, alarm has rung, and there is no burglary and there is no earthquake. Okay, so here we can simply apply our product rule and Bayesian rules. Okay, so so we have AND between this event. Okay, so there is John called you and Mary called you and there was alarm, right, like this. And if you recall the product rule, the equation will become like this, and for all this we have the probabilities which is indicated in our Bayesian network. Okay, so this is the Bayesian network. So probability of John calling you given A, so refer the table, so it is 0.9. okay, the probability of Mary calling you given the alarm is 0.7. okay, see, 0.7. then probability of A given there is no burglary and there is no earthquake is, okay, so this is 0.01. okay, and then probability of no burglary, okay, so probability of burglary is 0.01. okay, so 1 minus that would be the probability of not of burglary, and then probability of not of earthquake will be 1 minus this figure. Okay, so we have this. So probability of this event is 0.000628. okay, so this is how we can do inference using Bayesian network. Okay, remember Bayesian network is also known as belief network. Okay, so I think this is clear to you. Okay, so remember Bayesian network is actually a data structure, more specifically it is a directed acyclic graph. Okay, and here it is a directed graph, that means we will have directed edges. Okay, and that represents a casual relationship. It is acyclic. Okay, why it should be acyclic? Because consider this is two events, event A and event B. We have edge from A to B. Okay, so this will be acyclic. But what if we have this edge? Okay, now we have a cycle. Okay, now we are calculating. So if this edge is not there, we will calculate the conditional probability of B. So probability of B given A. Okay, now what if this edge is present? Now A is dependent on B, right? Okay, so this will introduce complexity, because now A is dependent on B, B is dependent on A. Okay, and the probability calculation will become intractable. Okay, so you cannot derive the probability now. Okay, so that's why our scenario should be a cyclic one. Okay, And more specifically, your Bayesian network should be a polytree. There is one more term. Actually, okay, I skip it intentionally, but let's be complete. So it should be a polytree. Okay, why? What is polytree? So consider this example. Okay, so this is the same graph that we have here. Okay, so we have age here. Okay, so now from the node, from the higher level to the lower level, you can see there is only one path. Okay, so if you consider this node and this node, there is a single path. Okay, but and that graph would be a polytree. And if I add one more node here, okay, now this is not a polytree, because if you consider this node and this node, now there are multiple paths now. Okay, so if you have a single path, then that tree is known as a polytree. Okay, and this Bayesian network should be a polytree also. Okay, because now the probability of this will depend on only one path. Okay, so this is all about Bayesian network. Remember this example, and through that you can remember this concept. Now we'll move to next part, that is approximation. Okay, so sometimes it is not feasible to calculate the exact value of the probability. That's why we have to go for the approximation algorithm. The main disadvantage of probability theory is that it severely dependent on the number of variables. As you can see, we have two variables here, B and E, and the number of entries in the conditional probability table is 4. Okay, so actually the formula is 2^n. Okay, so as you can see, there is a exponential growth in terms of the number of variables. Okay, so if you have 3, then the number of entries in the table will be 2^3, that is 8. Okay, so for high number of variables, the calculation of probability becomes very infeasible. Okay, and second reason is, so if you consider this probability, these probabilities are a priori probabilities. A priori means they are calculated in the past, they are calculated a priori. Okay, now what if your environment is changing? Okay, so these values will be wrong, right? This we have already calculated these values a priori, right? A priori means beforehand. Okay, and if your environment has changed, then this value will be incorrect. Okay, that's why in such cases also our probability theory fails. Okay, that's why we go for the approximate inference, where some error is acceptable. Okay, this approximate using approximation algorithm, you will not get the exact result. Some error will be there, but that will be acceptable. One of the approximation algorithm is known as Monte Carlo. This name is derived from the city Monte Carlo. It is a city from, I think, Monaco country, and it is popular for gambling. Okay, and we know that in gambling there is a randomness or some luck factor is there, right? Okay, so this Monte Carlo is actually a synonym for randomness. Randomness, and this is a randomized algorithm. It is a randomized algorithm. Now we'll study this algorithm through one example, and here we are trying to find a value of pi approximately. We will not get the exact value of pi, but we want a good approximation of pi value. Okay, this is a very popular example. When you study Monte Carlo, I think this will be the first example that you will study. Now here we have a field, a farm field. Okay, it is a square actually, and the side of that it is 2R, and inside that I have inscribed a circle, and the radius of that circle is R. Okay, so side of a square is twice R. Now our aim is to calculate the value of pi. Okay, so first I will calculate a probability. So it is raining there, okay, rain is falling over this square. Now the distribution of rain droplets is totally random, okay, and we have a good randomness there. So probability of rain droplet falling at this location, this, okay, so probability of rain droplet falling at this place is equals to the probability of rain droplet falling at this place, okay. So raining is uniform, okay. Now so probability of rain droplets falling in the circle, okay, so the probability of rain droplets drops inside a circle, okay, rain dropping inside a circle, okay, it will be equivalent to number of rain droplets falling inside a circle, okay, and number of rain droplets falling inside a square, correct, right now, okay. So and it will be proportional to what, their areas, right, okay. So the area of a circle and area of a square, okay. Now the area of a circle will be pi r square, and the area of a square would be twice r, and this side is also twice r, so 4r square, okay. So r square cancel out, and pi value will be equals to 4 into the probability of that event. Let's represent that by e, okay. Now we cannot actually count the number of rain droplets falling in this area, okay. So what we can do, we can do a approximation, okay. So for that I have written a Python code. See, so number of iteration is 100, radius I have kept as 100, circle points, this variable will keep a count of circle points, and this variable will count number of droplets falling in a square. Then I will iterate from 10 to that many, okay. So this sample means number of iteration, okay. These many samples will be placed. I am calculating the coordinate of the point randomly. For that I am using a library random, okay, and random function gives me the value, a random value in the range 0 to 1, and it will be a real number. I want a value from 0 to 100, okay. See, so this is my origin 0 and 0, okay. My radius is 100, so this is my 100, 0, okay. So I want this random value, okay, so at any place here, okay. So that's why I am multiplying by 100, radius, okay. I will get a random coordinates, then I am calculating a distance from the origin. So you might be knowing the Euclidean formula, okay. So and origin coordinate will be 0, right. So random x minus 0 and square of that, plus random y minus 0 and square of that, and then I will take a square root of that. So this will be the distance from the origin. If the distance of that point is less than the radius, then that point, that rain droplet will fall inside the circle. Anyway, that point will fall on square. So I am incrementing the square points by 1, and if it is within that radius, I will increase the circle point counter also. And then finally, our value was pi into 4 multiplied by that probability. So circle points divided by square points, okay, and that would be my value for pi. Okay, so now here the number of iteration is 100. So let us run for this, and we are getting 3.2. Okay, now this figure will improve if I increase the number of iteration. So now I am running for 1000. Okay, so 3.02. Let us run it again. Yes, we have a close value now. Okay, again we have close value. Okay, this experimentation depends on the random values that we are getting. If you get a uniform allocation of points, then you will get a pretty accurate result. Now if I increase the iteration, then I will get a pretty good result. Yes, let me print the actual value of pi also. Print actual value of pi. I think there is a constant in math library. Okay, so constants are denoted by capital letters. So okay, so I will print the actual value also. Has no attribute pi. Okay, I think this is pi is function. Pi object is not callable. Let me try this. Yes, okay. Actual value of pi. Okay, actual value of pi is 3.1415. Okay, and what we got, 3.16. Okay, so let it run for a higher number of iteration. Okay, now we have a good, now it is correct up to 2 decimal places. Let us run it again. Okay, again we have value accurate till 2 decimal places. Okay, so now you will not get an exact value, okay, but it is a close estimate. Okay, so this is how approximation algorithm works. Another example that I can give you is, suppose I want to find the average height of the person in the world. Okay, so what we can do? Okay, so this is world. Okay, so I have to take a sample from each country, right? Okay, so I will collect the samples from each country. Okay, now the sample selection should be unbiased. Now if you consider, if you just include the persons from Europe country, then the average that you will get will be higher, right? So the selection process should be unbiased, and you should collect the proportionate person from each country. Okay, that will depend on the population density, and your sample collection should be fairly random. Okay, and then if you take the average of heights of those samples, then you can get a close estimate of the average height of all the person in the world. Okay, so this can be another example. So this is how Monte Carlo approach works, and this is the graph. So for that pi value experimentation, so this is the actual value of 3.14 and 16, like that. And on the x-axis you have a number of iteration, and as you can see you have a stable reading after some point. Okay, so it is 3000 for that experimentation. Okay, so by this lecture I declare our syllabus is over. Some points I have skipped, but I think this much knowledge is sufficient for this chapter. Okay, so we'll stop here. In the next lectures we are going to study, I will we'll observe the previously asked question papers. Okay, we'll study them. We'll find out the important topics from this subject. Okay, so with this, I will declare that our syllabus is covered. I hope you have learned something new in this subject. We have learned different agents. We started with the problem-solving agents, then logical agents, and then game-playing agents. Then lastly, we have studied probabilistic agents, right? And we talked about nature of the environment, right? Like fully observable, okay?